so that you may know what is happening here at St. Mary Parish. Don't forget to get your lucky lottery numbers. Each three-digit number is $40 and is good from February 14th through December 31st. Numbers are going up, so don't miss out on all the fun. For more information, see the bulletin or contact Sandy in the Parish Office Center. We are in urgent need of individuals who can spend an hour with the Lord in our Divine Mercy Perpetual Adoration Chapel as adorers. We have several open hours, which are listed in the bulletin, and substitutes are greatly needed, especially in the night hours. Come and spend an hour with our Lord. Catholic Schools Week begins today. St. Mary Catholic School, recently named a National Blue Ribbon School, is now accepting registrations for the 2022-2023 school year. Call Jean-Pierre Giamma, Director of Advancement, at the contact information on page 2 of the bulletin for more information or to schedule a personal tour. In celebration of Catholic Schools Week, we are pleased to welcome Violet Walner, who will speak to us after communion about how St. Mary's School has influenced her life, and Mrs. Michelle Beck, who will speak to us now about the Board of Limited Jurisdiction. Our Lady of Guadalupe, please pray for us and an end to the coronavirus pandemic. Today is the fourth Sunday in Ordinary Time. This Mass is being offered for Alice and William Cornell, requested by Bill Cornell. Our celebrant is Father Bellapiti, assisted by Deacon Don Nichols. Our entrance hymn is number 662 of Breaking Bread, Save Us, O Lord, number 662. Please stand.
Arise, O Lord, hear people.
I know my heart.
Your faith.
Thank you.
I knew you. Before you were born, I dedicated you. A prophet to the nations, I appointed you. But did you gird your loins? Stand up and tell them all that I commanded you. Be not crushed on their account, as though I would leave you crushed before them. For it is I this day who have made you a fortified city, a pillar of iron, a wall of brass, against the whole land, against Judah's kings and priests, princes, against its priests and people. They will not fight against you, but not prevail over you. They will fight against you, but not prevail over you. For I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, strive eagerly for the greatest spiritual gifts, but I shall show you a still more excellent way. If I speak in human and angelic tongues, but do not have love, I am a resounding gong or a clashing cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and comprehend all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own, and if I hand my body over so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not jealous. It is not pompous. It is not inflated. It is not rude. It does not seek its own interests. It is not quick-tempered. It does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. If there are prophecies, they will be brought to nothing. If tongues, they will cease. If knowledge, it will be brought to nothing. For we know partially, and we prophesy partially. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I used to talk as a child, think as a child, reason as a child. And I became a man and put aside childish things. At present, we see indistinctly, as in a mirror, but then face to face. At present, I know partially. Then I shall know fully as I am fully known. So faith, hope, love remain, these three. But the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Prophet is accepted in his own native place.
Indeed, I tell you, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the sky was closed for 3.5 years, and a severe famine spread over the entire land. It was to none of these that Elijah was sent, but only to a widow in Zarephath in the land of Sidon. Again, there were many lepers in Israel during the time of Elisha the prophet. Yet not one of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian. When the people in the synagogue heard this, they were all filled with fury. They rose up, drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town had been built, to hurl him down headlong. But Jesus passed through the midst of them and went away. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So this week we also hear a continuation from that gospel we heard last Sunday when Jesus went back home to Nazareth, where he grew up, and he was invited to do the reading. He was the lector in the synagogue, and they handed him that beautiful scroll, and he opened it up, and the prophet Isaiah was written in that scroll, and he proclaimed that text. He didn't read it, he proclaimed it. And isn't there a difference from reading a text of Scripture and proclaiming it? Because in proclamation, you own it. When we speak to our lectors, we always remind them that. Please don't read the text. Proclaim it. Own it, digest it, read it, and reread it at home. And so when you proclaim it, it truly is the word of God that you're proclaiming. And all of the synagogue, their eyes were intently fixed on Jesus. He spoke very much with clarity, and they sensed it. He drew them in to the text. How often do we say that when we hear the gospel? Let's just not be bystander listeners, but let us engage ourselves into the actual scene, because the scene is about us. And we have to be engaged into the scene because Jesus is addressing us. Remember, we also say the scriptures are not held by time or space. How very true that is. So Jesus proclaims the reading, and he says, today the scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing. The scriptures tell us that all spoke highly of him. They were amazed at this Jesus. But after he spoke and he sat down, they asked him, isn't this the son, or they asked around, isn't this the son of Joseph? Because they could see Joseph taking his son to the synagogue, right? The guys would go together. And the father of the house would always take his son to the synagogue, preparing him for his bar mitzvah, getting all that prepared and teaching him, of course, the law and the prophets. How beautiful Joseph was chosen by God the Father to be the foster father of Jesus the Messiah. No wonder he has honor in this sanctuary, of course the mother of Jesus, but absolutely the foster father of Jesus, and that role specifically given to him by God the Father. So they begin to say about Jesus, isn't this the son of Joseph? This is his neighborhood that he grew up. This is Nazareth. See, when he began his public ministry, his home was Capernaum, right? And that's why they're questioning about him. When I was a deacon preparing for ordination to the priesthood, we would always say among our class, wouldn't it be nice if the archbishop would send us back to our home parish? And then after we read this, we're like, no, let them not do that, because they know us too much. Let's go somewhere else. But they were knowing him in the sense of an earthly person, nothing wrong, but just they saw him just as a common person. Like, okay, you're the son of Joseph. We know that you were raised in Nazareth. What's the big thing about you? And then he said to them, surely you will quote to me this proverb, physician, cure yourself. And say, do here in Nazareth what you've been doing in Capernaum. As if Jesus is going to come in Nazareth and just snap his fingers and put everyone back into shape. Which begs the question, what did they see in Jesus? Who were they expecting? What do they want from this Jesus of Nazareth? And what is Jesus' mission? What was he to do sent from the Father? And see, there's a struggle there, because there's many different camps about what they believe about Jesus. Those who believe him and believe everything that the prophets spoke about, that this is the Messiah. There's another camp that says, no, this is absolutely not the Messiah. Coming from Nazareth, Joseph is his father, Mary was his mother, he was born in Bethlehem as a little baby. This is not what God wanted us to have as a Messiah. No. There's people who believe that he is a blasphemer. How dare he speak this way? How dare he speak this way to us, the rabbis and the scribes and the Pharisees, who obey the law of Moses? He should be put to death. There's many different camps as they're voicing their concern. And that is why Jesus says, amen, I say to you. And I guess all of you good scripture scholars that you are, know that when Jesus says, amen, I say to you, he's saying, pay attention to what I'm going to say next. It's almost like a prelude of getting us ready. Almost like Jesus clapping his hands or snapping his fingers and saying, pay attention, because the next thing that comes out of my mouth, I want you to hold on to it. So every time we hear, amen, I say to you, that's exactly what I'm thinking about. All right, let's get ready for what he's going to say. No prophet is accepted in his own native place. Indeed, I tell you, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the sky was closed for 3.5 years and a severe famine spread over the entire land. It was none of these that Elijah was sent, but only to a widow in Zarephath. Now to you and me, maybe we don't understand what Jesus is saying, but to all those people, they were getting perturbed. You could see the smoke coming out of their ears when he's saying this. And about the lepers, that only Naaman the Syrian was cured. Because the people were very much fixated that this is the people, this group. Don't talk about Zarephath, don't talk about the Syrians, you talk about us. We're the chosen ones from God. Don't bring up examples of Elijah and Elisha, because we don't want to hear it from you. Because some of us don't even like you to begin with. And then you're going to put that on us? That's why you hear in the text today, when the people in the synagogue heard this, they were all filled with fury. They rose up and drove him out of the town and led him to the brow of the hill. Could you imagine how upset you were? On which their town had been built to hurl him down headlong. But Jesus passed through their midst and went away. What do you want of me? Do you want me not to speak to you with the truth? Sometimes the truth does hurt. Sometimes the truth, when you make an examination of conscience, we do get upset. When someone tells you something that you don't want to hear, but it's the truth, we get upset. And we have to simmer down. Just take it in. Because we know in our head it's the truth. What they're telling us, we don't want to hear it. We don't want anyone to be like, I have to tell you something. And then we take it in and we're like, and then we need to go away. Because we realize it's the truth. We need to digest it and start the journey again to restart ourselves. Jesus does this with many people. The leaders of the synagogue. The leaders of the community. And sometimes they're self-righteous because they really believe they know all this stuff. We know the Torah. We know the Pentateuch. We know the law and the prophets. Don't come in and talk to us about all this. Who are you? So I want to just give you a perspective where they're coming from. Sometimes you and I might be upset with God when he challenges us, when he asks us to do things, or when he puts situations in our path. Sometimes we don't want to hear that. Sometimes we just want to pray to God and say, here, do this. Just do what I'm asking you to do, God. Don't let me do something else that you want me to do, because I don't want to do that. I want you to do this and just answer this prayer. And if he doesn't, do we walk away? Do we get upset with fury with God? Are we upset with him? Even though you and I, when we pull aside, we know he's right. And it takes us time to digest it. To listen, to be obedient. Remember we talked about manifestation or epiphany? You heard that word many times. And I guess the first thing that comes to our mind when we say that is little Christmas, epiphany, the Magi, which is a good thing to spur our thoughts. Well, here that event was very crucial. It was just not about the Magi coming to pay respects to the baby, giving gold, frankincense, and myrrh. It was much more than that. It was about how God manifests now his plan for all nations. See how different this is? Not only for this people, not only for this group, not only for this clique, but for all nations. The Magi was coming from all different nations to come to adore, to to come before the newborn king to adore. That was the manifestation. That is something that we have to remember at Christmas, little Christmas. That he was born, and that's beautiful, but the next attachment to Christmas is the opening up of what Christmas is for and who Christmas is for. To allow that to sink in. And that's the purpose of the Magi, manifestation, epiphany. So Jesus says, yes, the widow in Zarephath, absolutely. The leper, Naaman, the Syrian, you bet. Remember the woman at the well? You bet. Her too. So Jesus sometimes would make them very much uncomfortable and would think that he is blaspheming. But what happens is that accusation turns into themselves. And they're not filled with the faith anymore. They have a different, distorted hope. And their love is with strings attached. So when Paul speaks to the Corinthians, we heard last week, remember when he associated the body of Christ, him at the head, and we're the members, and then he says, here, let me look at the human body, and let me try to bring this all around for you, that the hand cannot say it doesn't need the arm, and the foot cannot say it does not need the ears, and the nose cannot say it needs, does not need the legs. It all has to work together. And so Paul describes that beautifully, I think, by helping us to correlate the body of Christ, which we're all members of, through baptism, and Christ the head. And he tells us about faith. So, it's faith. What is faith? Is faith just an individual faith? Faith is absolutely a gift. It's a gift given to us by God, free and unmerited. How beautiful that we receive it. And that gift of faith, Jesus even says, in the size of a mustard seed, you could do tremendous things. You could say to the sycamore tree, be uprooted and transplanted into the sea, and it will obey you. You can move mountains with it by your faith, by your letting go and allowing God to come in, by surrendering to his will and not your own. Look at this surrender. Look at this sushi head. That's a complete surrendering to the Father's will or wishes for the salvation of the world. And even Jesus, at the night before he died, would say, Father, if this chalice can pass from me, let it pass, but not my will, your will be done. The humanity of Jesus, absolutely. But that whole submission, that whole surrender. I ask myself, so is your faith strong enough that you surrender what you want to what God wants of you? Confused, a little bit bewildered, but letting go and saying, let it be done to me. Sometimes not knowing what it all means, but letting God fill the emptiness of it. So that faith. And the hope that Paul speaks about, I love Paul says, hope saves. In Latin it's called spes salve. That hope saves. It's not a wish. Hope is not a wish. Oh, I wish there's a God, I wish there's a heaven. It's not a wish. It's a definite hope. There's a spiritual or theological hope that I am going to be with God for all eternity. That I am going to see the face of God one day. That I'm going to be in perfect joy and happiness in my glorified body with God. There is a hope that saves. And it's built upon that faith that I have. And here's where Paul brings it around like a nice glass of wine. He swirls that wine around. We all take a good sniff of it before we drink it. And he talks about love. And he says, this love is transcendent. This love I want my followers to have. I don't want strings attached to the love. Love is patient. Love is kind. It's not jealous. It's not pompous. It's not inflated. It's not rude. It does not seek its own interest. It's not quick-tempered. And then it does not brood over injuries. You don't hold on to it. Hold on to past hurts. You let it go. Remember what Jesus told us? Shake the dust from your sandals and move on. Stop clinging on to all the dirt in your life. Shake the sandals. Go! Because that's going to weigh you down like cement. Move! So this love is transcendent. And we ask for the grace, because you can have faith to move mountains. You can have the gift of tongues. You can have the gift of preaching. You can have the gift of discernment. You can have the knowledge of all the prophets. Who cares? That's what basically Paul says. Who cares? Because if you're not with love, it's empty. It's empty. Love fills it. And that's what it's contained. So as we gather to celebrate the Eucharist once again, as we journey with Jesus, let's all of us think about that. About what we understand Jesus is. What camp are you in? What camp are you in and I'm in? How do we view love and faith and hope? And how do we have them as the base of everything that we do and say? No strings attached, but letting go. And totally surrender so that God can fill us.
Let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through whom all things were made, for our sin and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our Savior was crucified on the cross of Calvary, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With hearts ready to receive God's blessings, let us bring our needs before the Lord.
For the Church, may the Lord bless our efforts to send out missionary disciples, ready to share God's goodness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For unrest in our world, especially on the border of Russia and Ukraine, may God bestow in his providence peace and security to his people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are infected with the coronavirus, may they soon return to good health with a confident faith in the mercy of God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us here, may the Holy Spirit help us to see pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We also remember Catholic Schools Week this week in our nation and locally here at our parish. May God continue to bless us and strengthen us as we proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, since he is the teacher and we are all students. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Eternal God of truth and love, you have shown us the way of holiness and perfection. Hear our petitions this day, for we make these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our offertory hymn is number 381, Breaking Bread, Servant Song, number 381.
Oh,
down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
You take away the sins of
Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. 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 The body of Christ.
Thank you.
leaders and who are business people, who are entrepreneurs in their specific field, whether they're Christians or not Christians, whether they're Catholic or not, that they all believe in the passion of Catholic education, especially in this culture and in this age and in this time, to rally around people who are like-minded and to work together for the good of the cause, its mission, and its purpose. At this time, I'm inviting one of our students up to speak to you, Violet, who will speak to you about her experience here at St. Mary's. Give her some love, everybody. Nourished by the redeeming gifts, we pray, O Lord, that through this help to our eternal salvation, true faith may ever increase in us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Now, Almighty God bless all of you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have a nice day, everybody.
Peace to Father.
Please join me in the St. Michael prayer.
St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray.
And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Our recessional hymns number 563, Ricky Brett. Lift up your hearts, number 563.
Yeah.